They're going to begin serving the salads now. So as I finish my remarks, as you get your salad, in the interest of time, please go ahead and begin. In addition to our wonderful friends and partners at Oak Spring Garden Foundation, I want to thank our sponsors for today, the National Council on White House History, represented by Debbie Dreisman here today and her husband, Frank Islam. As well as gifts from the Honorable and Mrs. Thomas Anderson and Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Rutherford. Thank you very much for your support. Now, this symposium, as you've heard, evolved from a small colloquium of scholars we had out at Oak Spring last summer. And this summer, our colloquium will be held at Winterthur, and it will be focused on decorative arts in the White House. And we will culminate that next spring with a symposium here in the Carriage House on decorative arts. We hope you'll all mark your calendars, although the date's not been set. Mark your calendars to remember that our next spring symposium is on the decorative arts. We've had a wonderful time in planning this with Winterthur, led by our good friend Carol Cadu, who could not be with us here today, but they are well represented by Catherine Dan Rober and Chris Strand, who are with us. Where are they today? I know they were going to be with us. There they are in the back. I see. Good to see you. I spoke this morning about Mrs. Kennedy, the founder of our association, and another important element of what she did and her legacy that's still alive in the White House today is the Committee for the Preservation of the White House, which advises the President and the First Lady on matters regarding refurbishment, redecoration, guidance on things for the state floor and for the House. Representing the National Council or the Committee for the Preservation of the White House is our good friend, the President of the Thomas Jefferson Foundation, Leslie Bowman, right here. So if you're getting a theme that partnerships and collaborations are a big, important thing to us, you're right. We love to take our wonderful, rich content and deploy it farther and widely and more wide and deeply through partners, collaborative partners. We are content rich, but we can be reach challenged. And the way we extend that reach is through our wonderful partners. And there's just one more I want to tell you about. And that's our partnership with Amazon Web Services. We started this 3 years ago as a way to take all the, we actually have about 200,000 images of the White House that we own, and we couldn't access them. But we wanted them to be accessible to scholars, to students, to authors, to journalists, even the White House Press Corps. But they weren't accessible. So through the help and support of Amazon Web Services, that digital library is now well underway. Also with them, we have developed the first ever app to tour the White House. So you can download WH Experience, and we'll be changing it seasonally to do the White House Garden Tour. We did the Easter egg roll. We'll do it at Christmas. And that's a wonderful thing. We've also developed with them a chat bot on White House history. Now, a chat bot, if you've noticed when you go to your bank and the little column pops up maybe on the right and you can have a conversation with someone about your bank account, well, you can now do that on our website about White House history. But even more advanced, we have now evolved our relationship with Amazon Web Services to an Alexa platform application. So if you will all indulge me, we're going to try it out here together at the Garden Symposium. So Alexa, start the White House History Guide.
Hello, please ask a question.
Alexa, tell me about the Rose Garden at the White House.
Adjacent to the West Wing, the Rose Garden provides a beautiful setting for outdoor ceremonies hosted by the president with enough space for guests and the press.
Alexa, how large are the White House grounds?
The White House fence encloses 18 acres of land managed by the National Park Service as part of the President's Park.
So when you go home today, talk to Alexa to continue your conversation about the White House gardens, the White House grounds, and about the White House Historical Association. Enjoy your lunch, and I'll be back to introduce our wonderful speaker in a few minutes. A Please continue to enjoy your lunch. But in the interest of time, we're going to go ahead and begin our program so that we stay on schedule. Dessert can be served and coffee will be served. Please continue eating. But if you would suspend your conversations, that would be great. I wanted to thank our good friend, Susan Pell, with United States Botanic Garden, who hosted the beautiful reception last night. And for those of you who had the opportunity to attend that, it was an extraordinary occasion. It was for our speakers and the supporters of this, but I didn't want today to go by without thanking Susan for her friendship and for that. And as I was going around talking with everybody during lunch, someone said, how do I become a member of the White House Historical Association? That's a true story, I didn't make that up. And I said, well, I'd be happy to, upon your request, answer that question. We are a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization. We have no government funding whatsoever. Every dollar that we give to the White House is a non-taxpayer dollar. And since 1961, we've been able to contribute over $50 million to the work back at the White House, in addition to the work that we do with education. So having friends like you is very, very important to us. But if you'd like to become a member of the association or join one of our donor societies, including the National Council on White House History, my colleagues, if you'll raise your hand so people know who you are, Rhett, Chandler, others, speak to one of my colleagues and they'd be happy to talk with you and welcome you into the family. Today, we have a very special treat to hear from Tony Willis, who is the librarian at Oak Spring Garden Foundation, which, as you all know, is in Upperville, Virginia, and was Mrs. Mellon's library and gardens and home before she passed and continues to be a library and gardens today. He began working for the Mellon family in July of 1980, and because of Mrs. and became, he was promoted to librarian in 1998, and he helped with the production of the Oak Spring Garden Library series and co-authored an Oak Spring Herbaria. He also was very collaborative with us in 2015 when we published an issue of our quarterly journal magazine that was on the Rose Gardens and Mrs. Kennedy's book that she scrapbook that she gifted to Mrs. Mellon, the one I've referred to several times that's inside. And it was the first time this had really been taken away and digitally photographed, and we used those photographs in an exhibit that we had here in 2015, and we have returned a digital copy of that photography to the library as well as to the Kennedy Library in Boston. They did not have that information, but they now do. So we've been able to work together over the past 4 years. Anita mentioned going out to see Thomas in 2016, and that really began the work, and Tony, of this symposium conversation, and how could we come together and celebrate the life and the legacy of this extraordinary woman, as well as others who influenced the gardens over the history of the White House. And that is the inspiration for today, and I hope you're enjoying it as much as we continue to. So with that, I would like to welcome Tony, and he's going to take us behind the curtain a little bit in terms of Mrs. Mellon and Oak Spring Garden Foundation. Tony.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tony Willis, the librarian from the Oak Spring Garden Foundation. And I had the great fortune of knowing and working closely with Mrs. Rachel Mellon, also commonly known as Bunny Mellon, for over 30 years. First, I would like to begin by thanking the White House Historical Association for the opportunity to be part of this wonderful symposium. It certainly takes teamwork to make events like this possible. And as Mrs. Mellon would often say, all those necessary details from the beginning to the last minute are very important, but also in helping to form new ideas and plans for the next project, event, or endeavor. In life, there is always more to do, and nothing is really finished. There is a strong sense of profundity in these words, as Mrs. Mellon was always designing, building, planting, and creating. During this symposium, we will not only learn about the historically important Rose Garden, but we'll hear of her other contributions to the arts, the fashion world, and the incredible legacy she left us. So the first, is the first image on of Mrs.? It is? I'm sorry. Okay, sorry. Is that good? Okay, sorry. I'm not too tech savvy, as you can see. So this first photograph of our benefactor, Mrs. Paul Mellon, was taken by Fred Conrad, who worked for the New York Times, for an article that the lovely Paula Dietz wrote. And in fact, it was the first article that was done on Mrs. Mellon in the library after the completion of her library building in 1982. It's a wonderful image of Mrs. Mellon. It shows her in her element, a confident gardener. And she's holding a wonderful standard tree. And it was one of her favorites of the many that she grew at the Oak Spring Garden, and in her personal greenhouse at Oak Spring, excuse me. It's of a Myrtus communis, or a myrtle. And like that one, there was many others that were lurking in the bays on each side of the formal greenhouse. Mrs. Mellon adored these trees, and she used them many times for various arrangements and for special dinner parties. Today, as centerpieces on these pretty tables, are a few varieties of standards that were grown at the foundation and brought here by our very talented head gardener, Judy Satstick, who is on this here. Raise your hand, Judy. There are rosemary, euonymus, curry, and myrtle. But Mrs. Mellon also grew thyme and santalina. But around 1950, she noticed that these herb trees had become a forgotten interest in the horticultural community. So while mending from an illness in her early 40s, she started several of these plants from minute slips. And over the course of time, she pruned and trained them into beautiful standard trees. Mrs. Mellon would often say, "They are living objects that have a medieval quality and can complement any interior setting as well. Today, they are generally referred to as topiaries, and they can be found in most nurseries and florists." Mrs. Mellon and I would often exchange gardening stories and plants from our gardens. And today, I would like to share a funny gardening story with you all. One Saturday morning, I awoke at the crack of dawn to work in my garden in Rectortown. My mission was to move as many wild violets, Viola odorata, to a location that had several wildflowers such as buttercups, wild mustard, and chicory. My neighbors and family members saw me working ardently, but thought this was a crazy idea. "They're just weeds," they exclaimed. Even the nice Jehovah's Witnesses that stopped by my house that morning thought this was an odd undertaking. However, my gardening friend and mentor, Mrs. Mellon, felt differently. She called me while I was transplanting the violets, and I explained to her what I was doing. After I told her, she roared with laughter and said she had done something very similar as well. Mrs. Mellon went on to say that she raised violets in cold frames and would often transplant them into open meadows. But on that day, Mrs. Mellon shared some important words of wisdom. And she said, "Never allow people to tell you what you should and shouldn't do in your garden. After all, trial and error is the best teacher." Then she proceeded to inform me on how she learned how to grow delphiniums in her greenhouse at Apple Hill when she was married to her first husband at Carter Hall. She said several people tried to dismay her from growing these flowers and that they would be too difficult to cultivate. But with great enthusiasm, her first seeds that she ordered from Sutton & Sons Limited, based in London, turned out to be the most beautiful flowers she had ever grown. Happily now, too, I can say my wild violets and other wildflowers are still flourishing nicely today. So the Oak Spring Garden Library. Here's an image of Mrs. Mellon's personal library, which is now a part of the Oak Spring Garden Foundation. The library is not far from the village of Upperville. It's beautifully nestled in the countryside between the rolling hills of the northern Piedmont region. By the young age of 13, Mrs. Mellon was creating gardens, growing flowers, and collecting books. Her penchant for acquiring rare and modern books, along with drawings and manuscripts, all derived from her need to have reference materials that supported her many gardening pursuits and ideas. This is how her library began, and her progression on becoming a talented landscape designer. Her first major book acquisition was The Flower Garden Displayed, authored by Robert Ferber, a British horticulturist who had a nursery near London. It's an early version of a nurseryman's catalog printed in 1734, and the volume contains 12 magnificent colored engravings of about 400 flowers, all grouped by the month in which they are known to blossom. In the early 1970s, at a social function in Pittsburgh, Mrs. Mellon was asked about her personal library. She responded she didn't have a specific library building or an area dedicated to just her books, and how they were unfortunately scattered about in several locations. The conversation inspired her second husband, Paul Mellon, to help her construct a separate building to house her exquisite book and art collection. In the spring of 1976, Mrs. Mellon began to work with the New York City-based architect, Edward Larrabee Barnes. Together, they drafted architectural plans for a new library, and soon after, construction began. The building was completed in the winter of 1980, and by the spring of 1981, her vast collections of natural history, horticulture, and botany were moved en masse to a new building, which she called the Oak Spring Garden Library. 2 decades later, another wing was designed for expansion purposes with the help of a local architect, Thomas Beach, from Earth Design Associates. The annex was completed in the winter of 1997. Today, the Oak Spring Garden Library is a thriving research center that contains approximately 19,000 objects, books, both modern and rare, manuscripts, drawings and prints, and other decorative objects. All are available for scholarly research and study. The collection encompasses horticulture and landscape design, botany, natural history, botanical voyages and travels, herbs and herbals, trees, flowers, fruits and fruit trees, architecture, decorative arts, and classical literature, poetry, and fairy tales. Mrs. Mellon would frequently say, "A library is built during a lifetime. It doesn't happen overnight." The Oak Spring Garden Foundation has also published 4 discursive catalogs that contain several of Mrs. Mellon's most beautiful books and manuscripts. And all of those objects are still in the library today. The first volume, An Oak Spring Silva, deals with the history of trees and tree cultivation. It was published in 1989. The second volume, An Oak Spring Pomona, talks about the history of fruit and fruit trees, and that was published in 1990. An Oak Spring Flora is the third, dealing with the history of flowers and botanical illustration. It was published in 1997 and then reprinted in 1998. And last, An Oak Spring Herbaria, A History of Herbs and Herbals, and we printed that in 2009. So here are a few treasures we brought from the foundation's collection, and as you will clearly see, they meant a great deal to Mrs. Mellon. So the manuscript, the famous Rose Garden manuscript, was given to Mrs. Mellon by Mrs. Jackie Kennedy in Antigua for Christmas of 1966. It is a remarkable work of Americana, documenting the Rose Garden in all its glorious stages, from its earliest planning with President Kennedy to various events that took place in the garden during his lifetime. It contains 151 folio leaves of photographs, plans, dried plant specimens, plant lists, correspondence, and artwork by Mrs. Kennedy. Next is, it did not, oh, sorry. Is that good? Sorry. So the other is, this was Mrs. Mellon's personal prose, go back. Is that it? Okay, sorry. Okay. This was Mrs. Mellon's personal proposed plan for President Kennedy and done on January 24th, 1962 of the Rose Garden. It is a mixed media, colored pencil, and crayon on tracing paper. It's mounted on a white board and then pasted to wood with green marble borders that Mrs. Mellon had done. It's signed lower right, Rachel Lambert Mellon, and inscribed extensively throughout by her. There is a sketch of the famous magnolia, the saucer magnolia, bottom left, and this type of magnolia, as you all know, was planted on all four corners of the garden. So next should be, okay. So this drawing was done for Mrs. Mellon as a final design for the Rose Garden. President Kennedy pretty much authorized all her ideas and plans with the exception of the tent. So make note of the tent on either your right or left. The work is entitled For the President's Garden, the White House, and it's dated 1962. It's all in watercolor and pencil on a very stiff artist board. Last and certainly not least is a preparatory drawing entitled Plan, and is signed and dated J.G. Roberts, 62. This work came to the library after Mrs. Mellon's passing in March of 2014. Its main concentration is on the steps, which were imperative to President Kennedy as he wanted a central step to be much larger and wider to serve as a platform for presentations and speeches. He also wanted a few steps for honorees to stand above him so they could be recognized for their importance. So those are just a few of the many treasures we have at the Oak Spring Garden Foundation. But in closing, I'd just like to say a few words by Mrs. Mellon. So too much should not be explained about a garden. Its greatest reality is not reality. For a garden, hovering always in a state of becoming, sums its own past and its future. A garden, like a library, is a whole made up of a set of separate interests and mysteries. I do hope you all can visit the Oak Spring Garden Foundation in the future, and please follow us online, www.osgf.org, to see what we are doing and how we are preserving Mrs. Mellon's legacy. Again, my heartfelt thanks, and it was an honor to be here today.